The next speaker. Okay, so the next speaker is Biltu Dan, and Biltu Dan did his PhD from ISI Kolkata, and he's a postdoc right now at ISC, and he's going to talk on the discrete membrane model on trees. Biltu, over to you.
Okay, thanks for the introduction. Also, I'd like to thank the organizers for this wonderful opportunity. I will talk about the discrete membrane model on trees. This talk is based on a joint work with Alessandra Cipriani, who is in TU Delft, Rajat Subra Hajra, who is in Leiden University, and Raunak Ray, who is in TU Eindhoven. The membrane model on the square lattice is studied in the literature as a random interface model for semi-flexible polymer or semi-flexible membrane. So let me first define what is an interface. An interface is the region separating two different phases. Many models in statistical physics display interface properties. So let us now see a picture where interface appears in nature. So this is a picture of Devprayag, where the river Alakananda meets the river Bhagirathi. And in this picture, this region is an interface. Mathematically, an interface is defined as follows. So let G be a graph with vertex set V and edge set E. Then an interface on G is defined to be the graph of a function from the vertex set to the real line. We write phi sub x for phi of x, which is considered as the height of the interface at vertex x. So let me explain it with a picture. In this picture, we consider the graph to be the lattice ZD. So at any point x on the lattice, phi sub x is the height of the interface. And in this case, the surface is the linear interpolation of these heights. Random interfaces are interfaces where there is randomness. So one defines a probability measure on the space of height configurations, that and that probability measure determines a random interface. Let us not go into how the probability measure is defined in general. Rather, we will consider two well-studied examples of random interface models. One of them will be the membrane model. First, let us consider the most well-studied example called the discrete Gaussian free field on the lattice ZD. We'll refer to it as DGFF in short. To define the discrete Gaussian free field, let us denote by Vn this box of side length 2n on the lattice. Then the discrete Gaussian free field on ZD with zero boundary conditions outside Vn is defined to be a Gaussian field with the following properties. So the heights are zero, fixed to be zero outside this subset Vn. And the vector phi x x in Vn is a Gaussian vector. The mean is zero, and we denote the covariance function by Zn. Now, if we extend this definition of Gn to the whole of Zd by defining it to be zero outside Vn cross Vn, then this Gn satisfies this harmonic boundary value problem. Here, delta is the discrete Laplacian defined by this, where f is any function on the lattice. Delta xy equals to 1 if x equals to y, and 0 otherwise. So it says that if you fix any x in Vn and apply negative delta to Gn as a function of y, then it is 1 if x equals to y, and 0 otherwise. Let me remark here that discrete Gaussian free field can be defined for any finite subset of the lattice, and for more general boundary conditions in place in other than zero. But for this talk, we will consider only Vn and zero boundary conditions. Alternatively, the discrete Gaussian free field can be defined via this probability measure Pn on the space of height configurations, and the probability measure is given by this. Here, d phi x is the Lebesgue measure on R, and delta naught is the Dirac mass at zero. So in this reference measure, this part tells us that the heights are fixed outside Vn, and this part says the Gaussianness of the model. Now, if we consider the matrix representation of delta, and if we denote by delta n the submatrix of delta restricted onto Vn, then one can show that minus delta n is positive definite, and the covariance matrix Gn is inverse of minus delta n. Our obvious question here is that when can we define the model on the whole of Zd, or one can ask that what happens to the measures Pn if we let n tends to infinity. We will answer this question in a couple of minutes. This is a discrete Gaussian free field on a box of size 30 cross 30. Let me now describe a nice random walk representation for the covariance function Gn. It is very useful in studying the model. So let Px be the law of a simple random walk started at x. Then Gnxy can be expressed as follows. So it is the expected number of times the random walk visits y before exiting the set Vn. So here tau Vn is the first time the random walk enters hits Vn complement. Okay, from here we can see that the term corresponding to infinite sum here is finite if the dimension d is greater or equals to 3, which implies the existence of the limit of the measures Pn. And that is indeed the case that the measures Pn converges to a measure which we call P if the dimension d is greater or equals to 3. This limiting measure P is called the infinite volume measure, or the thermodynamic limit. It is the law of a centered Gaussian field with covariance function which we denote by Gxy, and which is given by this expression. So it is the expected number of times the random walk visit y. So there is no condition of exiting Vn also. All right, so is the definition clear so far? Is there any question? Okay, if not, let us move on to the other example, which is called the membrane model. Which is the model of interest for this talk. The membrane model is defined similarly as the discrete Gaussian free field. The only difference is that here we consider delta square in place of that discrete Laplacian. So the membrane model on Zt with zero boundary conditions outside Vn is defined to be the interface with the following properties. So here also we are fixing the heights to be zero outside Vn, and the vector phi xx in Vn is Gaussian with mean zero, and we are denoting here the covariance function by capital Gn. Then this Gn satisfies this biharmonic boundary value problem. So recall that for discrete Gaussian free field, here there was minus delta. Now it is delta square, which is the discrete bi-Laplacian operator, which is defined as delta acting on delta. This membrane model also can be defined for any finite subset of the lattice and for more general boundary conditions. But as I said earlier, that for this talk, we will consider only Vn and zero boundary conditions. As an alternative definition, this model also can be defined by the measures Pn, which is given by this. This is same as the previously defined for DGFF. Only difference is that the operator here is the discrete bi-Laplacian operator. Okay, so now if we consider the matrix delta square, and if we denote delta square n to be the submatrix restricted to onto Vn, then one can show that this delta square n is positive definite, and the covariance matrix Gn is inverse of this delta square n. An important note here is that this delta square n is not equals to delta n square. So near the boundary, the entries differ. And this contributes to the difficulties in studying this membrane model. I hope there is no confusion with this notation. So the left-hand side is you first take square and then restrict, and the right-hand side is you first restrict and then square. All right. Here is how a membrane model on a 500 cross 500 box looks. This model was first considered in the probability literature by Hironobu Sakagawa in 2003. Then it was studied by Noemi Kurt in her thesis, and then by many others. These are few names who studied this membrane model. For this model, the infinite volume measure exists if the dimension D is greater equals to 5. In this case, the limiting measure P is the law of a centered Gaussian field, whose covariance function is given by this delta to the power minus 2xy. We call this infinite volume covariance function as capital G. Recall that for discrete Gaussian free field, we denoted it by small g. Okay. If we recall that we concluded the existence of let me mention that this was proved by Sakagawa in 2003 using Fourier analysis. And if we recall that for discrete Gaussian free field, we concluded the existence of this infinite volume measure from the random walk representation of the covariance function. So it is a natural question to ask, what about random walk representation for covariance function of this model? So let me start with the infinite volume case. So for the infinite volume covariance function, it is defined as the convolution of the infinite volume covariance function of discrete Gaussian free field with itself. And from that, we have the following random walk representation for the infinite volume covariance function. It says that if we consider two independent random walk, started at x and y, then this gxy is the expected number of times these two random walks intersect. This can be also expressed as this sum. This gxy can be expressed as this sum. Okay. Now the question is, what about g and xy, the finite volume covariance function? So an obvious guess is that g and xy should be this. That means we consider two independent random walk, Sk and Sk tilde. And then we define, we are guessing that GnXy is the expected number of times these two random marks intersect before any of these exiting the set Vn. But actually, in this case, this is not true. So let us denote this quantity by Gn bar xy. Then Noemi Kut in her thesis shows that in higher dimensions, this Gn and Gn bar are close enough, but only in the bulk. So near the boundary, this closeness does not hold. So the error is given by is of the order n to the power 4 minus d. So when d is greater equals to 5, this error is small. All right. So we saw that there is no nice random walk representation for the finite volume Copious function of the membrane model. The results that are obtained for this model was mainly by using discrete PDE techniques. Now we are going to see a new random walk representation for this covariance function Gn. One motivation is that this might be helpful in finding probabilistic proofs of the results that are there for this model. More importantly, the discrete PDE techniques are very much dependent on the structure of the ZD lattice. So we hope that this new random walk representation may be helpful to study the model beyond the ZD lattice. In fact, in this talk, we will see that we will use this new random walk representation to study the membrane model on regular trees. This new representation that I'm going to discuss is actually is nothing but the solution of the discrete biharmonic problem that we saw in the definition of the membrane model. And this solution was obtained by van der Waal in 1984. So it is a bit nasty to work with, but at least this will allow us to study the model beyond the square lattice. So let me now describe the new random walk representation. As you will see that unlike the discrete Gaussian free field, here all the successive heating times comes into play. So let us define tau I to be the I plus 1th heating time. That is tau zero is the first time that the random walk enters hits the Vn complement. And tau I is the first time after tau I minus 1 that the random walk hits Vn complement. So if we recall that tau 0 is tau Vn that we defined earlier, then we define Mj to be this product. Then for d greater equals to 3, the covariance function GnXy can be expressed in this way. So let me not go into the detailed explanation of this. Just notice that here in this sum, there is a eta t, which is a Poisson process with parameter 1 and which is independent of the random walk Sk. So actually, van der Waal obtains the solution of the discrete biharmonic problem for more general graphs. And for general graphs, this truncation by eta t is required to ensure that this series is finite. All right, so is there any questions so far? Okay, if not, then next we will define this membrane model on regular trees, and we will study this study this using this random walk representation. We will prove the existence of infinite volume measure of for membrane model on regular trees, and also we will study the behavior of the maximum of membrane model on regular trees. Let Tm be an m regular infinite tree, that is it is a rooted tree with the root having m children, and each of the children thereafter has m minus one children, we denote the root by O. Here we consider the set Vn to be a set of all vertices including and up to and including the nth generation. So here D denotes the graph distance. Then the membrane model on this tree Tm is defined similarly as on Zt. Here the discrete Laplacian is defined by this. This is same as that of the Zt case. Earlier there was 1 by 2D, now here it is M, which is the degree. Okay, so let us revisit for a second the definition of the membrane model. So here also the heights are zero outside Vn, and the covariance function and the vector is Gaussian. Note that here we are using the notation capital Gn for the covariance function, which satisfies this discrete biharmonic problem. All right. Here we consider m greater equals to 3 because m equals to 2 is the case z, and that is studied in the literature. And for m greater equals to 3, the covariance function has this representation. As I mentioned that van der Waals solution was for more general graph, and for regular trees, when the degree is greater equals to 3, then gnxy has this representation. So from this representation, we take out the first term corresponding to j equals to 0 and denote the remaining part by enxy, which we call as the error term. So this first term is nice to work with. The main hurdle is to analyze this error term. We obtained our results by estimating this error term enxy. We proved that this unxy in modulus is bounded by this quantity. As you can see that for fixed x and y, this goes to zero as n tends to infinity, and this implies the existence of infinite volume measure in this case. So we showed that for m greater equals to 3, the measures Pn converges to the limit measure P, and P is the law of a centered Gaussian field with covariance function given by this expression. So this is the limiting term corresponding to the first term in the previous slide's expression. So this is similar as the Zd case. All right. So in this case, the infinite volume covariance function has an exponential decay in terms of the distance between x and y. Let me mention here that for the lattice case, this decay was polynomial. So for the membrane model, this gxy decays like norm of x minus y to the power 4 minus d. And for the Gaussian free field, it decays like norm of x minus y to the power 2 minus d. And we use this exponential decay heavily to obtain our results. With the motivation from the Zt case, we now study the behavior of the maximum for this membrane model on regular trees. So we prove that if we consider the maximum of the heights over Vn, then after centering and scaling, this converges weakly to the Gumbel distribution. Here, the centering is given by this, and the scaling n is given by this. Notice that these are same as in the case when one considers IID Gaussians with variance Go, O. And the analogous result for the Zt case is obtained by Chiarini, Shipriani, and Hajra. Next, we study the behavior of the maximum for the finite volume model. And here, in this case, if you define psi x to be the phi x normalized by square root of its variance, then the maximum of psi x after centering and scaling converges to the Gumbel distribution. Here we have a restriction that M has to be large. So to prove this result, we actually need a finer estimate on the error term ENXY, which involves the distance between X and Y as well. And in order to obtain that estimate, there we got some restriction on M being large. We also prove that the expected maximum after scaling by square root 2 log cardinality of Vn converges to square root 2 G O comma O. Is there any question?
Sir, what are the trees you are considering? I missed.
We are considering regular trees. I mean, that means all vertex have same degree, and we are fixing one vertex and calling it as root.
Okay, and Vn is the everything within n.
Vn is all the vertices that are within n distance from that root.
Okay.
So Bildu, I have a question. Do you have any idea about the second order terms for the maximum or anything of that sort? And the other
let me conclude it in the end.
And I have another question, which is, so like your results are kind of similar to what would happen if things are independent, right?
Yeah. So the covariance is actually not playing a role in.
Covariances are not playing a role. So do you have any idea as to like where this transition happens? So here you're taking a tree with fixed branching number. If that becomes random, if there is a shift in there or not.
Those cases we have not yet considered. Actually in these groups we have heavily used the structure of the regular tree, which is very much regular, and we are yet to see what happens if we consider other graphs. And let me now quickly give the idea of the proof of the convergence of maximum. So for theta in R, we define un theta to be this an theta plus bn. Recall that an was the scaling and bn was the centering. So we are defining this so that we can show that maximum is less than equals to un theta converges to e^-e^-theta. Then we define by ix to be this indicator random variables, and wn to be the sum of these indicators. So note that the event Wn equals to zero is same as the event that maximum is less than equals to un theta. Then we prove the following result, that the total variation distance between this Wn and Poisson lambda n converges to zero, and the total variation distance between Poisson lambda n and Poisson e^-theta also converges to zero, where lambda n is the expected value of Wn. Once we prove this, then the result follows. We prove this fast convergence by using a Poisson approximation, which is obtained in a paper by Holstein Jansson using Stein chain method. In future, we plan to study entropic repulsion for membrane model on tree. That means studying the behavior of the model where there is a constraint that the heights are positive on a certain region of the tree. Also, we used to look on the properties of the model on more general graphs and maybe on random graphs. Here are the references. So this talk is based on this, which is available in archive. And this is a paper where we have used the Poisson approximation result. And this is a paper by Vanderbij, where he gave the solution of the discrete biharmonic problem. Okay, thank you very much for your attention.
Okay, thank you, Bildu, for a wonderful talk. So any questions apart from those already asked?
Okay, let me now go back to Rishidip Das questions. That in this case, actually, we don't have any for the finite volume, we don't have any specific idea about the second order of the maximum. So, and in this case actually differs from the ZD case, because near the boundary here, the number of vertices that are near the boundary is of the same order for the whole of Vn, which is not the case for the ZD. And what happens that for the ZD, we can prove, if we prove the result on a bulk of the of Vn, then that can be extended to the whole of Vn. Here it is not possible to extend the result on from the bulk to Vn. We have the result on the bulk of Vn, that the maximum with that same scaling as the infinite volume converges to Gumbel distribution, but we are yet have not sure that whether this can be extended to the whole of Vn. And does it answer your question?
Yeah, sure, thank you.
Any other question? So if not, let's thank Biltu again and all other speakers of the session. And I think this is the last talk. So see you again tomorrow.
Thank you.
Thank you, everyone, for attending the session. Bye. I think I'm going to close it.